Hello, I'm single-minded Ryan. In this video, I'm going to show you three things you have to know if you want to make a 2D top-down game in Godot. The first one is the white sword feature. The second one is a visual shader that's going to make the tree sway. And the last one is the glow effect. These are all very useful stuff, and let's get started. All right, let me quickly draw a bush to show you how to use white sword. Now I have the bush in my project. Before we get started, I want to briefly mention that the project I'm using here is from my latest Godot course. I just released it on Udemy. The course is going to help you understand how to make a 2D top-down game with Godot from scratch. I'll link a discount coupon in the description below. Please consider to give it a try if you're interested. Alright, go back to the video. I'm going to drag the bush into the game scene. The bush node is in the bottom of the scene tree, so if we run the game to test, we are going to see the bush is on top of everything else. This is obviously not what we want. So let's fix it with the white sword feature. But we do not need to enable white sword in the bush node. Instead, we put all of the nodes we want to sort under a parent node. And we just need to enable white sword in the parent node. In my case, I have put most of the nodes under the level node. Let me select the level node. You will see white sword is enabled under watering. So we just need to drag the bush node into the level node. Now let's run the game to check out the difference. The player should be able to get behind this bush if the Y position is higher. It works, but we have a small issue. The player only gets behind when it's higher than the center point of the bush. This is because Y sword is calculated based on the center point of the node. Let me show you how to fix it. I'm going to duplicate a new bush and move it to the right. Then I'm going to change the offset of the sprite. Let's decrease the Y value of offset, so the sprite is offset upward. And the center point of the node now locates near the bottom of the bush. Let's run the game to test again. Great, this is what we want. The player gets behind the bush at the right position, and we can compare to the previous one. Alright, now I hope you understand how white sword works in Godot. Let me just remove the previous bush node and add more bushes to the scene to test. First, let's create a new visual shader for the sprite 2D node of the tree. Then open the shader editor. Let me hide the things that we don't need to make more room. I want to briefly mention that the project I'm using here is from my latest 2D top-down Godot course. For the full course, please check out the link in the description below. Make sure we are in the vertex mode and add a UV node. We are going to use the green channel of the UV as the mask of the swaying movement. Let's remap the value of the green channel. This is going to reverse the mask upside down. Also leave the bottom area black, so the stump of the tree is not going to be affected. Next, let's multiply the mask by a float value. This value is going to decide the direction and the range of the swaying movement. To actually change the look of the sprite, we need to update its vertex. So let's add a vertex node. We only want to change the horizontal value of the vertices. So let's decompose the vertex node into a vector 2. Then let's multiply the x value by the value of the swaying movement. Now let's compose the values back into a vector 2. All right, now we can connect the final value to the vertex property of the shader. Now we can change the float value to check out the result. Next, let's find out a way to update this value to create a loop animation. We can do it using the time node. Let's multiply the time by a float value. Because the value of time passes really slowly, and we need it to change faster to randomize the speed, let's create a float parameter. We are going to set this parameter in the script with a random number. So let's name it random strength. You need to set qualifier to instance. We need this value to bounce back and forth. So let's connect it to a sine node. So the float is always between negative 1 and 1. Then we plug in this value and we are done. And this is the final graph for your reference. Next, let's update the parameter in the script. You can ignore the existing code in this script, since it has nothing to do with this shader. And we just need to add one line in the ready function. This line is going to update the random strength parameter with a random float number at the beginning of the game. All right, we are finished. Let's test the game. First, you need to set the render method to forward plus. Next, you need to enable HDR2D. Go to Project, Project Settings, then select Viewport under Rendering. Now let's enable HDR2D because the glow effect depends on the HDR value of the color. Next, to enable the glow effect, we need to add a world environment node to the root node of the scene. Let's create a new environment in the inspector. Then we can click on it again to expand it. Let's go to background and set mode to canvas. Now we can enable glow. Let's set blend mode to screen. I want you to pay attention to this HDR threshold, because any color with an HDR value that's higher than the threshold is going to glow. Let me show you how it works. I'm going to select the Animated Sprite 2D node of my player character. Then I can go to Visibility and change the modulate color. And let's increase the eye value to around 2, and you can see the entire sprite starts to glow. Basically, this is how we make the entire sprite to glow. But in my case, I just want the glow effect when the player is swinging the sword. So I need to create a mask to isolate the color that I want to glow. And I'm going to do it in a visual shader. So let's go down to create a shader material. Then click on it again to create a new shader. Make sure the type is visual shader. Then let me show you the color that I want to glow. I'm going to select the attack animation to the left direction. And I want this highlight color around the sword to glow. This color only appears in a couple frames in the attack animation. Next, let's open the visual shader we just created. Let me just hide the things we don't need to make some room. You need to make sure you are in the fragment mode. Before we go ahead to work with this visual shader, I want to briefly mention that the project I'm using here is from my latest 2D top-down Godot course on Udemy. In the course, I'm going to show you how to create a 2D top-down Godot game from scratch with good-looking game assets. And I'm going to leave the discount link to the course in the description below in case you're interested. Alright, let's go back to the visual shader. First, let's add a color node. You can find the color node under Input, All. Basically, this node represents the sprite itself. Let's connect it to a color operator node. Let's set the mode to Difference. Next, let's create a color parameter for the B input of the color operator. I'm going to name it to mask color and set the qualifier to instance. This is to make sure that when you have multiple characters using the same shader, each shader can have an individual value for the mask color property. Then let's connect it to the B input of the color operator. What we are doing here is that we compare the mask color to the color of the sprite, and we are going to get a black color as a result when the two colors are the same. Let's connect the color operator to the color property of the output. By the way, if the mask color parameter doesn't appear in the inspector, then you might need to deselect and reselect the animated sprite 2D node. Now we can see the parameter in the inspector. Let me set it to the highlight color that I want to glow. I'm just going to put in the hex code here, since I already know the hex code of the highlight color that I want. And you can see the area near the sword becomes black, because the color of this area matches the mask color I just put in. Alright, next, we need to turn this black color into a mask. Let's connect the color operator to an if node. Let's set the color for the A equals B condition to white. Let's put 1 in all three channels, so we get the white color. Then we connect the if node to the color property of the output. Nothing happens because we need to increase the tolerance. Let's create a float parameter for the tolerance. Set qualifier to instance, and let's set hint to range. Usually for tolerance, we just need a very small number. So let's set mean to 0.001 and set max to 0.003. Now we can tweak this parameter until we see the white part of the mask. Good, we have successfully isolated the color we want. And let me also double check to make sure it works for all attack animations for different directions. Seems like everything works very well. So let's go back to the shader editor. We want to use the mask to change the color of the highlight area. Let's add a switch vector 3D node. Then connect the mask to the value input. Then we connect the color node, which is the original sprite, to the false input. For the true input, let's create a new color parameter. I'm going to call it glow color. Set qualifier to instance. Now we can connect the switch node to the color property of the output. Let's set the new glow color property to the same color as we used for the mask color. Then we just need to increase the I value of this color to make it glow. I'll just set the I value to a number around 2. And we should be able to see the glow effect. If I go to the third frame of the attack animation, alright, we get the glow effect. We can select the world environment node to tweak the settings. Alright, now let's test the game. That's it for this video. I hope you have learned something new. And please check out my new course on Udemy from the link in the description below. Thank you and see you next time.